I now call the meeting to order. Good evening, everybody. Can we all please raise our right hand for the national anthem? A very good evening to everyone. I have a little announcement, in fact, a big announcement to make that I would like to thank Dr. Huzaifa and Samina for organizing a vaccination drive for our club. So we will be following all the government rules and regulations. All members who are above 45 years of age and have comorbidities are eligible to take the vaccine. Also, and this is open to parents, and anybody who is above 60 years of age, what they need to do is basically go and register on the Cowin app and do not take an appointment. Okay, this we are having our drive on the 10th between 12 to 3. After you guys finish registering on the app, kindly register on the Google form. So according to the entries that we receive on the Google form, we will be giving appointments, like time slots will be allocated to all the members so that there is no crowd over there and there is smooth operations. So I hope everything is clear. Yes? Great. So this is, again, it is on the 10th between 12 to 3. So now moving on with the evening, I would like to welcome our stars, Pritam and Himalini Sawan. Dipen, can I request you to introduce them, please?
Sure. Can you hear me?
Perfect.
Great. Okay. So, Dr. Himalini Sawant has been in practice for 20 years. She has completed a dual fellowship in pediatric ophthalmology and neuro-ophthalmology from Sankara Netralaya, Chennai. She spent 5 years working there as a consultant before starting a private practice in Mumbai. She is currently a director of the Eye Associates of Mumbai, Team Eye Clinic and Laser Center at Opera House, and also honorary professor at JJ Hospital. She is honorary at Jaslok Hospital and does charitable work at Pramukh Swami Eye Hospital in Chembur. Apart from adult cataracts, she practices pediatric strabismus and neuro-ophthalmology. Dr. Pritam Sawant has completed his retina fellowship from Sankara Netralaya and was working there as a consultant for 5 years before starting private practice in Mumbai at Hinduja Hospital. He is also an honorary professor at JJ Hospital since 17 years, where he has trained several fellows and students. He is currently a He is currently attached to Induja Hospital and also the director at the Eye Associates Mumbai, Team Eye Clinic and Laser Center Mumbai. Besides that, for those who don't know, Dr. Pritam is our, the Rishabh Pant of our team, of a cricket team. Right, we actually put him in the gloves and the helmet. He would actually look like Rishabh Pant in his body stature. Right, and for Dr. Hemalini, she's been my, I've known her since school, so a very good friend of mine. And today they're going to be talking about something about myths and some things that about eyes, which they're going to debunk those ideas very harshly. So over to them. Pritam, we can't hear you.
Thank you for the introduction, dear Dipen. You know, I was waiting for that wicketkeeper thing to come because that's my the biggest feather in my cap is being a wicketkeeper for the Rotary Club of Bombay Wavy. Thank you.
Most welcome.
Thank you, Smita, Karthik, for having us here. It's just a different feeling because I don't feel like I'm giving a lecture to some audience. I'm just feeling like I'm talking to my family. So it's a nice feeling. It's going to be a wonderful evening. Emma, you want to add before we start?
No, I agree with you.
So, we want to keep it like a dialogue. We have some some questions which we've come up with. These are questions which routinely not just our patients, but our friends and our relatives ask us. It's not necessary that we have to debunk the myths. We can have a healthy discussion on some of these topics and these myths about eye care. So I'm going to share the PowerPoint presentation and start off right away. Can you see the slide?
Yes.
You know, and I'm going to encourage everyone to ask questions in between, okay? We are family, no formalities here. Just start your mics and just ask. If you have a point to make or a question to ask. So the first question is actually for Hema's. So here, you know, there are some questions which Dr. Himalini is going to take, some questions which I will be discussing because our own subspecialities are pretty different. Although both of us are eye surgeons. So I think this first thing, yeah, Hema, it's yours.
Thanks, Pritam. Okay. The first question is, can too much screen time or online work affect the eyes? Now, we purposely chose this question because of the current COVID times. Everybody's work has shifted online. And the worst in this category to suffer are the children. Because for children, not only has a school shifted to online, but even the homework is shifted to online. Even the extracurriculars are happening on Zoom. And post-extracurriculars, their free time, that is watching movies or whatever else they do, everything is related to the laptop or the iPad. So the question is, can too much screen time or online work affect the eyes? So what do you think the answer is?
Yes.
Yes, of course. So how does online time or screen time affect the eyes? Number one, when you're looking at the computer all the time, the eyes tend to get a bit dry. Now, doing online work for 6 or 7 hours without taking a break, it's like me telling you that tomorrow you have to run a marathon suddenly without any training, and you have to run 7 kilometers, 10 kilometers continuously without taking a halt. Now, if you do that, at the end of the day, your leg muscles are going to cramp. So same way, if you're going to do so much of online work, which is your actual work, plus your homework, plus your Zoom classes, plus your extracurriculars, then at the end of the day, the eye muscles get tired. And when the eye muscles get tired, they go into a state of spasm. And when they go into a state of spasm, transiently, everything becomes blurred and they pull on the wall of the eyeball, as a result, causing it to elongate and therefore inducing a minus number. So right now, I have so many patients, at least one or two children coming every single day who have seen them for the last 2 or 3 years, no glasses, but all of a sudden, they've landed up with a minus number. So how do we help these children or how do we prevent their number from increasing? So the most important thing to follow is the 20-20 rule. what is this 20-20 rule? Ideally, after every 20 minutes of online work, you're supposed to see something at a 20 feet distance for 20 seconds. Now, this is not practical. So I tell my parents or the adults or the children that after every 45 minutes or 1 hour of computer use, whether it's laptop, whether it's iPad, whether it's a mobile phone, any kind of gadget use, take a break for a few seconds, count 1 to 20 in your mind, and then proceed ahead. Apart from that, I advise them to put some lubricants, which are like tear substitutes, because the light from these gadgets cause a lot of dryness. The third thing, a lot of times parents ask me, do blue filter glasses or anti-glare glasses help when you're doing online work? So the answer is no, because the American Academy has clearly given guidelines saying that the amount of blue light that is emitted from your gadget is of a minuscule quantity, not requiring the use of a blue filter glass. So don't spend your money on blue filter. Instead, make sure that you take frequent breaks. Any questions with this? Any comments or questions with this? Or I'll go on to the next one.
I'm sure a lot of y'all also, you know, have probably experienced a lot of itching and redness following a lot of computer use. So one good thing, which are, you know, like a first aid for that, is, you know, to apply ice packs. Ice packs on the eyes decrease the redness, decrease the amount of itching immediately.
You know, what is the conclusion for watery eyes? Like, as you said, with your screen time, you have a lot, I face a lot of watery eyes.
So basically, taking a break will help, and putting tear substitutes. So anything like Just Tears or Refresh Tears. There are so many in the market. I could, you know, message, if anybody wants to know, I'll message them personally. But there are a lot of drops in the market. They are preservative free. They have no side effects and can be used by anybody, any age group. So avoid using Ayurvedic preparations, but these pharmac preparations are very, very effective.
Splashing
of water on the eyes, isn't that good?
You could do that, but I generally just basically tell them take frequent breaks and put the tear substitutes. That should solve your problem. And in general, you've got to limit the amount of screen time, because your eye muscles are not trained to do this much of screen time work. So you've got to limit it, you've got to dosage it, you've got to discount it. You can't stop it, but you've got to discount it.
After 20 minutes, should we close our eyes for 20 seconds? Or
you could do that. You could do that. You could close your eyes for 20 seconds. That is excellent. Or just take a walk around your house and come back again. Or look outside the window, see a pretty face and come back again.
Good idea. Good idea.
Okay. We'll go to the next question.
Screen time also includes...
Sorry?
Hi, Pritam. Television screens.
I didn't get that question. Sorry?
Only computer screens or even the television screens can also affect the
television screen is not so bad, because television screen is at a distance. Anything which is at a distance is not so bad. So in fact, I encourage children that if you want to watch something on the YouTube or a cartoon or something, then it's better watch on the TV rather than holding it here. So most of the parents are in this habit that when they want to feed their children, they give them the iPad. So instead of that, if you have to do that, then make them watch the TV. That is better.
Thanks.
So go to the next question. Can eye yoga or exercises please?
Excuse me, Emma. Can I ask? This is Vimal here.
Yeah.
Hi. There is a myth about, is it okay to splash water in the eyes or it is not advisable? So
I personally don't advise splashing water, because... I mean, instead of splashing water, there are tear substitutes available. You could do that. But saying that, splashing water is not bad either. If you want to do it, do it. But I don't personally advise that.
Okay. Thank you.
The second question is, can eye yoga or exercises decrease the spectacle power? Why have I included this question? Because again, I get a lot of kids. And the moment I break the news to the parents that, oh, your child or your daughter has a Chashmika number, all hell breaks loose. Now, I reassure them, and I'm telling you guys also, that having a Chashmika number only means that there's trouble focusing. The internal health of the eye is probably as good as yours and mine who don't have glasses. So you don't need to worry about, oh, my child has glasses. Of course, nobody likes their 5-year-old and 6-year-old with glasses, but saying that, you don't need to panic. So they commonly fall into this trap where they read about exercises or some friends recommend, oh, go do some yoga for the eyes and the spectacle number will go. So that is a myth. Remember, the number has come partly because of genetics and partly it has come because of the length of the eyeball. The longer the length of the eyeball, the higher the number is. I'm only talking about minus number right now. So when you do any kind of eye yoga, which is palming or looking at the pendulum going to and fro, or looking at a candle or things like that, you cannot shrink something that has grown long. So therefore, doing eye yoga or any kind of eye exercises will not reduce the number. So don't fall into this trap. But when parents come and ask me this question, I try and make them understand. If they don't still understand, I tell them, look, if you want, you can go and try out these eye yoga exercises if you want to, if you're very keen on. But don't omit the glasses and don't put any medicines inside the eye. As long as you're okay with that, I'm okay with you doing any eye yoga. But scientifically, eye yoga or eye exercises is a waste of time. It does not help in reducing the eye power. And most important take-home message with this question is that having an eye power or a spectacle power only means that there is trouble focusing. But the internal health of the eye is as good as yours and mine who don't have glasses. So accept it and move on. Okay?
Both of us are wearing glasses.
Any questions for this, or we can go on to the third one?
So you guys study too much.
Okay, we'll go on to the third one. You want to take this one?
So you only take
it. The third question, again, a very, very common question that we're always asked. Can cataract be removed with laser? So most of my patients, I tell them that, look, what you understand as laser is actually ultrasound energy. It is the ultrasound energy and the which is used to break your cataract. And then this kind of a special probe is introduced inside the eye. And the cataract is like a cake. We do a piecemeal of the cataract and your pieces are sucked out. Now the machine, the procedure is called as phacoemulsification. And the common layperson calls it laser. So any patient will come, amaro motio laser thi kadvana chone. So we tell them, yes, laser thi kadvana che. Apne bina taake wada karvana che. And recovery is usually within 48 hours. But there is a so-called laser also, which is being marketed, which is different from the conventional phaco. The actual difference between the traditional method, as you see here, and the laser method, which is shown here, is not much. You're using the same instrumentation, the same phaco machine, the same everything. The only difference is that the first step of the surgery is done with a special type of laser. Long-term side effects of this laser is not yet established. So if you come to me and you ask me that, you know, you will have to do a cataract surgery with laser, I say yes. But if you want the special laser in inverted commas, then it's an additional 20,000-30,000 for which you don't need to get into. So what I'm trying to tell you is that when any patient asks laser method, it's actually ultrasound energy. The surgery is called as phacoemulsification. It is a stitchless surgery and recovery is usually within 48 hours.
So the only difference is, if you see in the left side of the slide, it is this phaco probe which cuts the cataract first, then churns it up and sucks it. In laser, it is a laser which cuts, but ultimately it is a phaco probe which has to churn it and suck it. The laser does not have the capacity to remove the cataract from the eye. So this is the absolute scientific aspect of the difference.
And there's no added benefits. Now, even if you go for the laser method and you pay up 20,000-30,000 saying that, oh, I'm doing the laser method or the
probably
special
more.
Method, you're not doing any favor because it's not, the end result is the same. Any questions?
Any questions anybody has? Because this is, you know, we have a lot of queries regarding this nowadays. Okay, well, let's move on to the next. So this is now the ball is in my court now. So about diabetes, you know, this is a very common question. A lot of patients are diabetics and, you know, they are under the impression that, okay, my diabetes is under control. By whatever reasons, I'm controlling my diet, so my diabetes is under control. Or I'm taking medicine, so my diabetes is under control. So if my diabetes is under control, my eyes are safe. But is it so? No, not necessarily. in spite of your diabetes being under control, your eyes could still have this kind of a picture. You can see here, these are hemorrhages, blood spots inside the eye. This patient probably has as low as 5% vision. You can see on this left-hand side, you can see these yellow spots. This is actually sugar deposits inside the eye or lipid deposits inside the eye. And this could be in spite of diabetes being under control. So we have to remember here that if your diabetes is under control, does not mean your eyes are safe. You need regular eye checkups. You need at least to have an eye checkup once in 6 months or at least once a year. And I'm not talking about eye checkups where you go to an optometry shop and get your number checked. That is not an eye checkup. When I talk about a diabetes eye checkup, it means getting your retina checked, getting your fundus checked. Fundus is the same as retina. So a fundus examination, you know, where we put the drops to dilate your pupil. After putting those drops, the vision becomes hazy for 2-3 hours. And then we are looking inside the eye. If we are able to detect diabetic retinopathy at this stage, then with the help of treatment, we are able to restore the vision, save the vision. But this gentleman probably here, you know, it's too late. Even if we try a lot of surgeries and lasers in this eye, this person is not going to get back about probably about 20-30% vision. So the take-home message for this slide was that in spite of your diabetes being under control, your eyes could still be in danger. So make sure that they are checked regularly. Any queries on this, please?
Yes, doctor. At what age should one start getting his eyes checked?
Very good. That's a very good question, Pradeep. So normally we say, you know, all problems start after 40. When we say 40, you know, a layman will just say, oh yeah, you mean the reading glasses? No, not just reading glasses. Problem called glaucoma, where the eye pressure goes up and can damage the optic nerve. This usually starts after 40. Things like, you know, diabetes itself, diabetes, blood pressure, these are problems which come after 40. So their effect on the eyes will come after 40. Then you have age-related degeneration in the retina, which usually comes after 50. So as a routine, once you cross the age of 40, 45, we say that every once in a year, you should get your eyes checked. That is the rule of thumb we advise.
And is there a permanent cure for this? Suppose if I'm a diabetic, then my eyes have got spoiled. Is there
That's why I put these contrasting. See, this person on the left, you know, this person on the left is probably has only few lipids.
Okay.
Sorry.
Yeah.
So if this we were to treat at this stage, this is called as the first stage. Okay. If we were to treat it at this stage, we will be able to restore his full vision. Mm-hmm. Probably he doesn't even have vision loss. So we'll be able to save his vision. But here, the gentleman on the right, you know, this is really the advanced stage. You can see this is a blood clot inside the eye. So even if we were to, with surgery and laser, we were able to remove this blood clot, this gentleman would probably still be left with only about 25 to 40% vision. So at this stage, the disease becomes irreversible. At the early stage, the disease is reversible. So, you know, the saying goes, a stitch in time saves nine. So that's the whole point here.
Doctor, a question.
Answer one query. Pradeep, you asked that what is the right age to do an eye examination? Pritham only spoke about adults, but some of us may be having children or have friends who have younger children. The first eye check for a young child should be anything between 3 and 5 years of age. It is possible for us to see children as early as even 1 year of age. We have special techniques. So if you suspect something, then earlier. But otherwise, the normal routine age would be anything between 3 and 5 for the first eye check
preschool,
in a child.
Preschool. Preschool is what we call it.
Doctor, this is Vimal here. I need to ask, what is the eye pressure? You mentioned the term.
That's the next question. We'll wait for that.
We are coming. There's a slide on that.
Okay. Yeah. So, doctor, can I ask my question now?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, see, as when we go by a routine health checkup, there is never a mention of an eye checkup in that. So, if from what you're saying, it's a very important aspect. Maybe your practitioners can emphasize to hospitals that they should mention an eye checkup also is required. You know, when you go to a health checkup, you have heart, you have diabetes, you have PSA, you have other x-rays and all that, but never have I seen an eye checkup written there.
So that's a very good point, Pradeep. But you know, nowadays there is something called a diabetic clinics. Within corporate hospitals, within hospitals, you'll find a diabetic clinic where you have a diabetologist, you have a diabetic foot specialist, you have an ophthalmologist, and you have a kidney specialist, nephrologist. These four people doing that checkup together. So these kind of preventive healthcare is picking up in our country now.
But Pradeep, I don't know where you get it done. We get it done at Hinduja. So they do a thorough eye checkup also. So next time when you go, you
can... at Beach Candy. So I never came across.
You try Hinduja. So, they do
Pradeep, Beach Candy does not have an eye department. And that's the reason why eye check is not mentioned.
Fair enough. No, but it's good. It's enlightening because we who, like I do a health checkup every year. So I was surprised to hear that. If it was not because of you, I would assume it was some other doctor. I would say they are just trying to encash it. But when it's coming from your mouth, I know that is not the case behind that. Yeah. So I'm just trying to express that. And there are other hospitals that have gone for health checkup and never has the list of eye in the checkups written eye checkup. Or maybe there's another word for that, which I was not very much so aware.
In this side of town, I know Jaslok, Saifi, Reliance, you know, these hospitals do have eye checkup.
Complete eye checkup.
But also when you go for the eye check now, you must insist on a dilated fundus examination because many a times they also at the hospitals are in a hurry and you've got so many things packed up in one day. So they just do a Chashmika number check and they send you home. So you have to insist, you have to make sure that your Chashmika number is checked, your eye pressures have been checked and your retina has been checked by putting the drops. That would be a complete eye health check for the eye.
Perfect. Now, so just a matter of awareness is being created. Maybe your fraternity can also inform the hospitals that they need to have such test to be in place and there has to be a body that checks on them that are they doing it in such a manner.
Yeah, that's a good suggestion. We'll go to the next question.
My slides are not moving. Can you see my slide?
No, it has not moved. It had moved earlier.
Not the diabetes one.
One second.
Stop and start.
No, I'm just going to stop, share and see because I'm not able to move. No, it's stuck.
So you want to shut the presentation and start it again?
Let me see. I'll just do that.
Just manually go to the other slide now in your list of slides. Just click on manually another slide and then share it.
Yeah, I'll do that. Yeah, can you see the next one?
Yes.
Okay. So, you know, I am a healthy person above the age of 40. And can I get glaucoma? So someone asked about the eye pressure, right? So what is eye pressure? So just like we have a blood pressure. So blood pressure is the pressure of blood in our vascular compartment, right? And when blood pressure goes up, we know that, you know, we can have headaches. We can get a stroke. So in the same way, the eye pressure itself is a pressure of the fluid inside the eye and the pressure that fluid exerts on the nerve of the eye. So this is on your left hand side, this is how the nerve looks. You can see how the nerve, this is the optic nerve, the beginning of the optic nerve. It starts from here and runs all the way to the brain. That's the connection of our eye to the brain. Now this is a healthy looking optic nerve, you know, pink, red in color. But if you compare it to the optic nerve on the right side, what do you think is the difference in color? It's looking
darker,
whiter, right? It's looking pale. It's looking white, right? And if you see, look at the blood vessels here. The blood vessels are coursing into, you know, very smoothly. But you can see the blood vessels here are not going to the center. They are all pushed to the periphery because the pressure is so much in this eye that it has actually caused an excavation in the optic nerve. Now imagine the optic nerve, which is such a delicate structure behind the eye, and you have this excavation within the optic nerve. So this is what glaucoma does, you know, high eye pressure. And this is a silent killer because, you know, you will not come to know, this patient probably is not even aware that this has reached this stage, because what it does is it starts sort of, you know, it starts obliterating your peripheral vision. So your central vision still remains normal, but you will start initially seeing, you know, you'll have problems while driving. You'll get into accidents probably. During nighttime, you'll find driving difficult. So these are very subtle signs which you're not able to pick up. By the time you reach your physician, your eye specialist, you will have already advanced glaucoma. You know, and by that time, it becomes very difficult to reverse it. So like someone asked, what is eye pressure? And like we discussed, after the age of 40, when you go to an eye specialist, you have to tell them that, do I have glaucoma? You have to screen, you have to get your eyes screened for glaucoma. This is the must. Hema, you want to add?
Yeah, and also, you know, people who with family histories of glaucoma, so if they have their mothers or fathers who've had history of glaucoma, now sometimes you may not know that they have glaucoma because your parents may say kalapani. So the nickname for glaucoma is kalapani.
Jhamar.
Jhamar. Gujarati is called it jhamar. Bihari is UPA, it's called it kalapani ho gaya hai. So if you have a family history, then all the more reason why you should be even more careful, because patients whose parents have glaucoma, they have a high chance of getting glaucoma, and the incidence is more after 40 years. This is again another reason why we say that do not do your routine eye checks at the Chashmewala ka dukan. Having a 20/20 vision does not necessarily mean that all is well. So you have to come to an eye doctor, and you have to make sure that the eye doctor checks the eye pressure. So you have to keep this in mind.
And mind you, glaucoma is irreversible. The nerve which looks like this, you know, once you start treating it, you cannot again look like this. So you cannot go backwards. You know, you can only stabilize it. You can stop the progression. You cannot reverse it.
Also, sometimes I've heard some friends saying that, you know, I was just a glaucoma suspect and the doctor ran so many unnecessary investigations on me. They're just making money. But believe me, we're not making money. If you're suspecting somebody having glaucoma, or if I have to rule out glaucoma in a person, there is a glaucoma package that we offer patients where we have to do two or three tests. Only when you put, you know, two, three tests together, then we can come to a conclusive diagnosis whether you truly are having glaucoma or you don't have glaucoma. So never suspect that, oh, why am I doing so many tests? And then in the end, I didn't have glaucoma, but I paid 6,000. Well, you've paid 6,000 for a good cause, so don't worry.
So if you have, if you diagnose with early onset of glaucoma, then what is the solution to that?
It's eye drops. So you have to keep, it's just like blood pressure medication, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You have to keep putting eye drops for a long part of your life. That's the only way.
There's no solution to this at all.
There's no absolute solution to bring the eye pressure down. It essentially involves putting a long time, you know, long-term eye drops. And these have to be diligently put, you know, by the clock every day at certain time.
Yeah, I know. You know that my mom-in-law is doing that.
Yeah. And the optic nerve is a very sensitive nerve. It is the only nerve in the body that cannot regenerate. So once damage done, it's done. Cannot regenerate the lost vision. And therefore, careful.
And since you asked this question, if drops don't work, the drops is the first line of treatment. If drops don't work, then there are lasers and surgeries.
We'll go on to the next.
So one second. I have a question on this. I think I'm on the onset of glaucoma. I think I had come to you, Himalini, and you had only
detected. Yeah.
So I was. So I have no eye drops or anything to be put, but I get my eyes checked, not maybe every year, but for glaucoma every year and a half or 2 years. So do I need to do it more regularly now?
No, once in a year is more than enough.
It's good because I have no eye drops and it's always on the borderline.
Yeah, so once in a year, I remember your case, Meghna. So you're a glaucoma suspect. You don't have glaucoma yet. We ran a gamut of investigations on you, and we put it as, okay, you're a glaucoma suspect.
Correct.
But you have to keep doing what we did once in a year for sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then if it's still at that borderline, then I don't need drops.
Then you don't need
exactly
anything.
So you can precipitate into a glaucoma, a clinical glaucoma. And
okay,
that we'll know only when we keep testing you regularly.
Okay.
So you know, and if you disappear suddenly 3-4 years,
after that, I've been doing it at least a year
glaucoma
and a half or 2 years, so I do it once.
Yeah.
With three tests.
Yeah. So that window of picking your clinical disease will be there only if you keep regularly checking.
It is so sad that what has happened because of COVID, patients who had glaucoma did not come for their follow-ups. Some of them randomly stopped their drops.
I haven't got my eyes checked in for glaucoma in 2 years now because one year went in COVID.
I work in a charitable hospital and it's so sad because we see so many patients who've lost vision because they did not follow up, because they could not come out because of the lockdown. Sometimes the drops were not available. They couldn't do the follow-up. Okay. They've come up with blind eyes and we cannot do anything to help them.
No, I think I need this checkup ASAP now because it's 2 years now.
Sorry, we'll go to the next question.
Ingna, go tomorrow itself.
Yes, I will.
So this again, there is, it's stuck up. Okay.
So I'm 50 years old. Can I get rid of glasses with LASIK? So this is a gentleman. I think he must be 50. This is with the glasses and this is a picture of him without glasses. All of us want to look better without the glasses. That's true. But, this is a very controversial question. I'm 50. Can I get rid of my glasses with LASIK? The answer to this question is yes. And it's a no. Why is it a yes? Because there are, fixed parameters that we check. And only if you pass in each and every parameter that we advise that, okay, if you're very, very keen, then you could go ahead with LASIK. There's no problem. But keeping in mind that we can only correct one number. So most of us at 50 have double numbers. Dur ka bhi hai, nazdik ka bhi hai. Very few of us don't have the nazdik ka number. So they think that, okay, at 50, I'm going to be completely spectacle free. No. I can make you spectacle free only for distance, but you will still need your reading glasses. If that's okay with you, then yes, you could do LASIK provided you've passed in all the 5 or 6 tests that I've subjected you to. Even if there's the slightest doubt in one of the parameter readings, then no, you're not a good candidate for LASIK. Also, the other thing that you have to keep in mind is when at this critical age, they say, oh, but how long will I get the benefit of LASIK? I'm already 50. What if I get a cataract? So I don't know at what age you're going to get a cataract. The general age at which you get a cataract is around 60-ish. Saying that, there are patients who are younger than 60 and get a cataract. And then you'll have your grandmothers who are 80 and they don't have a cataract. So there is no fixed age when you're going to get cataract. The day you get a cataract, you will have to do another surgery, although you've done the LASIK. So you have to keep that in mind. And then the third thing is that suppose you get a cataract soon after you've done the LASIK, don't think that the LASIK caused the cataract. It's just your bad luck that the cataract happened a couple of years after LASIK. So if you are at 50, that critical age, I would say even 40, between 40 and 50, think twice before you want to do the LASIK. We don't push people to do the LASIK at this age, but if they're very keen for whatever reason, then yes, if all the parameters are normal, then yes, you could go ahead with LASIK. The earliest age at which you could do LASIK is around 18 or 19 years of age. LASIK is very popular for minus numbers, followed by cylindrical numbers, and least popular for the plus numbers. So any questions
on this?
I heard that you have this something called, I think, lens replacement through which you can also remove your plus and minus both.
Yeah.
But that needs to be at certain age when your eyeball or something stops growing or something. I heard it, something of that sort.
Yeah.
So the eyeball usually stops growing at about 21 years of age. So,
I'm talking about maybe this comes after 50, 55 or something.
So what you're talking about is lens replacement, which is like how you do Motiyaka operation and you have a cataract and you remove the cataract and you put an artificial lens inside. So here, correct. What you're talking is that at 50 years of age, mujhe chashma nahi pehna hai. So remove my normal lens inside the eye and replace it with an artificial lens, which has got a distance as well as near correction. But mind you, Sanjay, this is a surgery. And whenever you do anything invasive, there's always a chance of something going wrong. So if you're not having any trouble, then I would advise you to stay away from any of these procedures.
But your question is very valid. Means the other option to doing LASIK at the age of 50 to get rid of your glasses is this lens replacement.
So
the procedure is called CLE, clear lens extraction. Because the lens is clear, it's not cataract.
So, you know, recently in our practice, we did have a model who walked in, and she's very high profile. Her visual needs are very different, and she was very cosmetically inclined. You know, her face all done up with Botox and fillers and blah blah blah. She didn't want to wear glasses for reading. Now, after spending almost an hour or 2 hours with counseling, that saying that no, this is not a great procedure, it's a surgery, there could be side effects, we almost tried to dissuade her. She had already done her homework and come, and she said, you know what, even if there's that 1% risk, I still don't want to wear reading glasses because it's hurting my profession. So keeping that in mind, we went ahead and we did a surgery for her where we removed her clear lens and put in an artificial multifocal lens with which today she is spectacle free. That means she can see the distance also clearly. She can read also clearly. Of course, she took some time to adapt, and there was this anxiety period where she would keep coming back and saying, you know, doc, I didn't think it was going to be like this. I didn't think it was going to be like this. Now, you know, I'm having a little trouble in my contrast and all of that. Eventually, she got used to it. But you know, when you do these kind of surgeries, it's not only pressure for the patient, but it's a pressure for us also, because then, you know, a lot of expectations are very high. And in general, anything which is not required, why do you want to do it? So unless your professional requirement is such that you have to be 20/20 without your glasses, I won't advise any such procedure.
Correct. So invasive, anything invasive is risky after all.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Thanks.
Go on to the next question.
So I'm seeing black spots of lotus in front of my eyes. What can they be? Now, you know, this is a very normal thing. I'm sure all of us have experienced this, that, you know, when you look into a very bright background, you'll see these small dots floating in front of your eyes, or small hair-like matter in front of your eyes. Now, routinely, these small dots and hair-like things are cells inside the eye. Everyone after the age of, say, 30 or 40 will get these cells. And just seeing these dots really is not a problem. But in a small percentage of patients, these dots could be accompanied by some scratch in the retina or a hole in the retina. And that can lead to what is called as retinal detachment. If you look at the picture here, the retina here at the bottom is very well attached. But you can see what has happened to this retina. This is the upper retina of the eye, which has folded over the lower one here. So this is a patient with retinal detachment, and this patient probably has zero vision right now. So if you get floaters, if you're seeing floaters, although it is benign, although it is something you can, you know, you don't have to be worried about, but you can't dismiss it, because a person with floaters could have small tears in the retina and can lead to this. So one has to visit a doctor. Even if you have floaters, you should visit an eye specialist, get your retina checked, and make sure that you're not at a risk of developing retinal detachment. Because, you know, like we say, prevention is better than cure. If we see small tears in the retina, we can stitch them up from outside with laser. And then you will never have this problem of retinal detachment. So this is a very specific, important thing we wanted to convey today, that seeing black spots and floaters, do not dismiss it. Get your eyes checked.
The common person refers to these black spots as machhar ghoom raha hai aankhon ke samne, makhi ghoom rahi hai aankhon ke samne, the cobwebs dikh rahe hain aankhon ke samne. So these are the common words or descriptions used by the patients. You know, many a times your parents may complain to you. So now you know that you have to keep this condition in mind.
Next one.
What is the cause of this condition?
It's age related.
So one is, it is age related. People, you know, because of, after a certain age, you can develop, what happens is the jelly inside, there's a jelly inside the eye. This jelly contracts after the age of 50 and it pulls the retina and tears the retina. And that causes retinal detachment. The other,
it's very
other,
common. It's very common.
It is fairly common. It is not very common. It is, but, and it is more common in people with minus numbers, what we call as myopia. People having minus spectacles, their eyes are not circular, their eyes are oblong, oval. So it is more common in those people.
Okay.
That's the next one. So, you know, people, a lot of people, you know, at our age, they ask that, I have heard of vitamins of the eye. Can they help? So the answer is yes. There are nowadays vitamins available. You know, the one on the left is an Ayurvedic preparation. The one on the right is an allopathic preparation. These are essentially antioxidant vitamins which are prepared. These vitamins are more common. They do not stop things like cataract and glaucoma, but they do strengthen the eyes, especially for people who have dry eyes. They can be helpful. There's people who have retina problems like retinal degenerations, they will be helpful. But one has to remember that vitamins are not a treatment. Vitamins are only a support. So, but these vitamins do help.
Plus, saying that we're not endorsing these products or anything like that, but just a word of this thing, advice is that, you know, I strongly, you know, being a student of medicine, I believe in allopathic preparations. I don't know about Ayurvedic and homeopathic medicine. So I have some patients coming, they're taking homeopathy medicines and all. I don't endorse the allopathic one, but at the same time, you know, if you're taking homeopathic medicine, you better know the content of that medicine. So if you're clear on that, I don't have a problem.
Is there any certain foods that they say nowadays you got to eat carrots and all that? Does it
vitamin A rich foods are in general very good for the eye, because all these orange color fruits are rich in vitamin A, and vitamin A is good for the healthy function of retina. But it is more important in the low socioeconomic status who are vitamin deprived. You and I are more than well fed, so we don't need to have vitamin.
Okay, so you know, this is similar to the diabetes question. So I am a patient with high BP, blood pressure. Will it affect my eyes? So, you know, it can. The answer is it can. So high blood pressure, just like it can cause a stroke in the brain. Stroke means essentially the blood vessels in the brain are not able to take the pressure and they burst. Same way, you can see this blood vessel in the eye, the retinal. You can see the upper blood vessels are normal, but see this lower one, this has burst. And it has caused this hemorrhage inside the eye. So we call this as a branch vein occlusion. And when this happens, the vision goes for a toss. Vision is lost. Now, the best way to prevent this is, again, to get your eyes checked. If you have blood pressure, although the blood pressure is under control, your eyes must be checked. The other thing which it can cause high blood pressure is this kind of a hemorrhage. Now, this hemorrhage looks, you know, it can look scary. But believe me, this is more benign. This is just a subconjunctival hemorrhage on the outside of the eye. This hemorrhage within 10 days time will resolve and the eye will look white. But something like this, which is not seen from outside, can lead to permanent vision loss. So one has to remember, if you've been diagnosed with high blood pressure, even if your doctor has said that you don't need medicines for high BP, just control, reduce your salt intake, you still need to get your eyes checked, because blood pressure can affect the eyes.
Again, this picture that you see on this side with this red color thingy, this is little blood that has come. This can come not only if your BP is high, but it can also come if you've rubbed your eyes very vigorously, if you've itched your eyes very vigorously. Suddenly in the morning, you'll wake up and you'll say, "Arey, my eye is looking red." So whenever I get a call for this kind of consults, I tell them, "Okay, first go and check your BP. If your BP is normal, then I kind of reassure them, start them on some drops, and this will take for 10, 15 days to go."
I think, yeah, that's it. So that was the last one. Thank you, everyone. Do you have any questions? I hope everyone is awake.
Trying very hard to be awake, Pitam.
Pitam, sometimes you have some kind of prick on your eye. It feels like a prick. What is that?
A pricking sensation?
Yeah.
So that is typically dryness. See, what happens is, you know, you have tears, right? Eye tears. Now, the job of the eye tears is essentially to coat the surface of the eye. Our eyes are extremely, the surface of the eye, the cornea, is the most sensitive part in the body. And, you know, and the tears coat the eye so that normally our eyes don't feel like pricking. But these tears, they sort of evaporate and they break up. So people with dry eyes, the tear film breaks up faster and that causes pricking. Now, you know, our modern lifestyle involves sitting in the air condition for long hours. We are driving a car with the AC blast on our eyes. Okay. We have so much of pollution. We have construction work going on with concrete in the air. All these things are catalysts for causing the tears to break up faster. that leads to dry eyes and causes pricking. So we mentioned in the beginning of the talk, you know, like things like these tear substitutes. There's a drop called as refresh tears, or a drop called as just tears. These drops can be used temporarily, you know, if you're experiencing pricking sensation, and you can avoid that.
So one question, Preetam.
Yeah.
Sometimes you feel that there is some, you get some kind of a small kachra in the eye, and you always feel that something is there, and you keep rubbing it, but obviously nothing is there. Is there a big issue behind that, or is it just a normal eye tiredness?
Sorry.
So he's saying that it's a sensation of kachra in the eye. Sometimes you get. Is it normal or is it something to worry about?
Nothing to worry about. First, I reassured him, saying the same thing: dry eyes and put some drops. And if it persists in spite of putting that, then we need to see on the machine to see if you have any chota foli hair, concretion hair.
If you were to look into the mirror and just take your lower lid, you might find some white spots. These are called concretions. So what are concretions? You know, your dust particles which sit over there, the body reacts and sort of covers them by a calcium deposit. So these yellow spots are nothing but the body's response to protect your eye from the dust, the infection. You know, and sometimes these concretions cause that khatakna-like sensation.
Correct. That is the exact feeling I get, yeah. Okay, I'll check. Word back.
Any more questions?
One more question. What lifestyle you should change to see that your eyes are like chaka chak?
It's a $1 million question, KV. So routine eye care. You know, see, we always tell people. I think we mentioned that above the age of 40. You should get an eye checkup done, because there are a lot of eye problems which can be detected at a very early stage. See, technology has, you know, has gone in leaps and bounds. We are detecting eye problems even before they manifest. So routine eye checkup.
Somebody is talking. Mute.
Apurvan is too. Apurva, mute yourself.
So one thing is regular eye checkups. That is extremely important, Kalpesh. Yeah. That is the best way you can detect things before even they manifest, you know. And then, like we said, limiting your screen time, you know, not rubbing your eyes frequently, using this tear substitute eye drops, using eye vitamins.
In general, there's nothing prophylactic that you can do. I don't recommend any drops so that your eyes remain chaka chaka or anything. Your eyes don't need that kind of care.
You know, the commonest myth is, you know, television. A lot of mothers are worried about television. Now, watching television per se, you know, a couple of years ago when we used to have those TV screens, you know, they used to have cathode rays and tubes inside. Those cathode rays and tubes used to have radiation, gamma radiation. Now, in the times of LED and plasma, there's really not much of radiation coming from the TV. But remember, when you're watching the TV, you're looking at a screen, you're staring at it. So there are other problems. You'll have your eye muscle spasms, strain on the eyes, you'll get dryness, you know. So somewhere or the other, you're going to have some eye problems by watching long hours of television.
Can you get rid of the bifocal thing?
We just said no, you can't get rid of both. Either durka ya jayega ya nazdika, more often durka.
Okay.
Ya phir tu तेरे को एक आंख में दूर के लिए करके दो और एक आंख नजदीक के लिए करके
सो दैट्स वन कांसेप्ट ऑफ मोनो विजन
नॉट
लॉट ऑफ पीपल आर हैप्पी विद दैट बट
सो प्रीतम केवी आंसर्ड योर क्वेश्चन यू नो व्हेन यू आस्क इज एवरीबॉडी स्लीपिंग सो केवी जस्ट वोक अप एंड आस्क्ड द क्वेश्चन व्हिच वाज ऑलरेडी आस्क्ड
थैंक्स अ लॉट दैट्स ग्रेट आई रियली एंजॉयड इट आई एम सॉरी आई हैव टू लीव थैंks प्रीतम थैंks Himalini.
Awesome.
Thank you.
Our pleasure.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Any more questions?
I have a question.
Yes.
And now again, this is a little based on because when I go to any naturopathy center, they make you do this eye wash every morning.
That's exactly what I'm saying, that it doesn't work. So putting those cups of water into your eyes with rose gel or whatever it is that they put is not required. Your eyes don't require washing. So there is no need to do
that. See, routine cleanliness, you know, when we get up in the morning, we do wash our face, wash our eyes. So it's having the same effect. Nothing really different, Gautam.
Noted. Thanks.
I did this in Atmantan last year when I went. They made me do all these things every day in the morning.
So this is a routine thing to be done fancily.
Okay.
Nothing wrong with it.
Pritam and Hema, thank you very much. This has been like a superb talk, very informative, so many myths busted. Thank you very much, guys.
Thank you,
Smita.
Thank you
for the
much.
Opportunity. Yeah, Sanjay, can I invite you? Thanks, please.
Yeah, sure. So, hello.
Yes.
Yeah, so Pritam and Himalini, thank you so much. On behalf of the club, I would like to thank you all both. You guys, given us a great eye-opener. In fact, got into our eyes and every detail of it. And I'm sure each one of us are feeling very confident about, how we can take care of our eyes post this session. So thank you so much for such a detailed talk on eye care.
Thank you, Sanjay.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
So much. Amrita, can I invite you for your secretarial announcements, please?
Yes. Hi, guys. Good evening. We've had about 50 logins today. The next meeting is on March 6th, which is a joint meeting with Rotary International President-elect Rotarian Shekhar Mehta. March 8th, we have the medical camp at Priyadarshini Park. March 10th, we have a joint meeting with Sanjay Goradia. And on March 21st, we have a sports fellowship. We'll send in the details soon. That's all we have for the evening. Thank you very much. Have a lovely weekend, guys.
Thank you, Amrita. And the meeting is now...
Thank you.
The meeting is now adjourned.
Thanks. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. See you. Take care.
Bye-bye. Good night. Have a nice weekend.
Thanks. Same to you guys.
Thank you.